Hello friends, welcome to webinar number 8. We are going to talk today about the approach about the abnormal chest radiograph. And to see that, let's go to the first case. It's case number 1. It's a cone down radiograph of the upper chest in a 27-year-old man with seminoma who has pain in the anterior chest wall. I think you see the lytic lesion in the proximal right clavicle. I'll give you a cone down view so you can see it better. And I'm offering you 4 diagnoses. 1, is this a metastasis? 2, an infection, osteomyelitis? 3, is a benign bone lesion? Or 4, if you cannot make up your mind, you can say any of the above. Now you can stop the presentation now and at home examine the abnormality, make up your mind, and come back when you are ready. Okay, we are back, and let's analyze the lesion. There is an obvious lytic lesion that is eroding the lower part of the distal right and proximal right clavicle. But there is an important finding here, that the lesion has an sclerotic border that you can see very nicely here. And a lesion with an sclerotic border is by definition benign. So if it is a benign lesion, we can exclude metastasis and we can exclude osteomyelitis. And the correct diagnosis should be a benign bone lesion without discussion. But this is not a normal benign bone lesion. This is a normal variant, which is called a rhomboid fossa. The rhomboid fossa corresponds to the insertion site of the costoclavicular ligament, which is seen here in yellow between the first rib and the clavicle. It's a normal variant and should not be mistaken for an osteolytic lesion. It's not uncommon. It occurs in 30% of the males and 5% of the females, and as we get older, it slowly disappears. Let me show you some examples of rhomboid fossa. Sometimes it's uni, other times it's bilateral. Here we have a bilateral rhomboid fossa, a small one on the left side, and a larger one on the right side. Notice the persistent sclerotic border, which is also the hallmark of this lesion. And other cases, very evident, very striking, but still normal. One rhomboid fossa on the left, another one, a very large rhomboid fossa on the right. And this, again, said is a normal variant and should not be confused with the lesion. I'm showing this case because when we see an abnormality in the chest, our first question should be, is the abnormality significant? Because if it's so, then we can do the necessary workup. And if it is not significant, then we identify it as such and we don't do any further workup. And the rhomboid fossa is a nice example of non-significant variant. The first conditions that give, that offer normal, that offer non-significant abnormalities are normal variants. They usually involve the skeleton of the chest. And I mark here 4 of them, in my opinion, the more common. The rhomboid fossa that we already mentioned, the supraclavicular foramen, bone islands, and pectus excavatum. The supraclavicular foramen is a small orifice in the middle third of the clavicle, either the right or the left. Okay, we can see over here, and we'll see better in the cone down view. It's a small orifice, a small hole with a sclerotic border and should not be confused with a real lesion. I know people have called that sometimes osteoid osteoma, but it shouldn't be called osteoid osteoma because it's normal. And I have seen even a case that was operated on because of this finding. So it's a supraclavicular foramen, which is not uncommon and should be distinguished from any pathological condition. The next condition, which is reasonably common in the chest, are bone islands. Bone islands are sclerotic lesions of the ribs, with predilection of the pelvis and ribs, of course, and occurs in the rib in the chest X-ray. And when they occur in the ribs, if they are not apparent, they are not very obvious, they may simulate a pulmonary nodule or a bone metastasis. Here we have the radiograph of a 55-year-old man, asymptomatic. At the first glance, the chest appears normal. If we look carefully, we see a small nodule over there, superimposed over one rib. And on the countdown view, doesn't look calcified, and it seems slightly irregular. So obviously, a CT has to be done. When we do a CT, we don't see any abnormality in the chest in this area, no nodule. However, we see a small calcification, calcified sclerotic lesion there, which in the coronal reconstruction is obvious that is a bone island in the seventh right rib. That is the appearance, typical appearance of the bone islands. Can be diagnosed in the playing field or suspected, and if not, we can have to do a CT, and we have to think of that. Another patient, routine chest film in a 49-year-old woman with breast carcinoma. You see the elevated breast, the prosthesis here, and the skeleton is apparently normal. I said, if we look very carefully, we detect a sclerotic lesion there in the 11th rib. There it is. We can see it better in the countdown view. There. A sclerotic lesion in the 11th rib. This abnormal. It is a metastatic lesion, especially from a carcinoma that had given a sclerotic metastasis. Well, we look at the previous film, 2015. 3 years earlier, and it hasn't changed. Very well seen. Just to be sure, we took an oblique view of the ribs, and there at the 11th rib, we see the typical appearance of the bone island, and therefore this is not an sclerotic. This is not a sclerotic metastasis, and it is non-significant finding. So that's something that we have to know. Pectus excavatum is the third abnormality, the third normal variant I want to talk about, and is fairly common. This occurs at 0.3% of the population, and can give several manifestations. The most common one is a blurring of the right heart border, and sometimes it can give a sort of an opacity, as we see in this patient, in the area of the right middle lobe, simulating right middle lobe disease. In this patient, nothing was suspected because a lateral view was taken and there was no disease in the area of the middle lobe, obviously, and the changes were due to a moderate pectus excavatum, which is very easily diagnosed on the lateral view and difficult to see in the PA view. Another patient is a 23-year-old man with mild chest pain. Patient has a slight scoliosis and an apparent increase of size of the cardiac silhouette. With mild chest pain, a possible suspicion may be pericarditis in a young person, but again, in the lateral view, what we see is a marked pectus excavatum with narrowing considerably the diameter, AP diameter, between the spine and the pectus. And of course, the heart is displaced towards the left because it has no possible room in this such a small area. And there was a pectus excavatum simulating cardiomegaly. In conclusion, to finish this first part, remember, normal variants are a common cause of non-significant finding, have to be known, important to recognize the most common one to avoid confusing them with disease. I have mentioned the four ones. I think they are most common, but there are several others that you had to know about. Let's go now to case number two. This is a 23-year-old man, asymptomatic. And obviously, there is a very striking abnormal appearance of the right hemithorax and the right lung, and also on the lateral view. There are abnormal opacities there. And I'm going to give you four possible diagnoses: that this patient has right middle lobe disease, that this patient has a right lower lobe mass, it is a congenital lung malformation, or number four, it is none of the above. And remember the first tenet: whenever we see any abnormal chest, we have to ask ourselves, is the abnormality significant? Well, with this, let's stop the presentation at home. Then make up your mind, because this is a complicated case, but easy to diagnose if you know what you look for. And then when you are ready, come back to the presentation. Okay, we are back. And now let's analyze the finding. Apparently, this patient is very sick because the right lung look awful. But remember, the patient is asymptomatic. So let's try to find a reasonable way to explain the findings. The first thing that's call our attention is this possible mass here. Obviously, we don't know what it is, but it's very worrisome. Okay, let's keep looking. The mediastinum has shifted to the right, and there is blurring of the right heart border, simulating disease of the right middle lobe, which is not present because on the lateral view, you don't see the typical triangular shape of the right middle lobe. So we can exclude right middle lobe disease. If we continue looking, we see that the right hemithorax is smaller than the left. And when we have this combination, displacement of the heart and mediastinum toward the right and a small right hemithorax, the first thing that should come to mind in an asymptomatic patient is a congenital hypogenetic right lung, what is called the scimitar syndrome, because it has an abnormal vein going down to the inferior vena cava. We are not going to make the diagnosis with the facts I just mentioned, but we had to suspect congenital hypogenetic lung syndrome and then look for the scimitar vein. And you see what you look for, and you look for what you know. In this case, if you look for a scimitar vein, you are going to find it over here, going into the mass, curiously. See, scimitar vein is going here. So now, once you discover a scimitar vein, you can make 100% diagnosis of a hypogenetic right lung syndrome. This patient has a congenital absence of one or two lobes of the right lung and has no pathology. This is a non-significant finding. And the CT proves all the other findings, different projection that I am not showing you. But here you can see nicely the right scimitar vein draining into the inferior vena cava. And interestingly enough, the mass that we saw over here is not a real mass, it's just a hernia of the right hemidiaphragm, which is a normal component of the syndrome. Okay? Congenital hypogenetic lung syndrome. I'm showing you that because the second conditions that show non-significant findings are congenital lung malformations, which are, in my experience, are not rare in adults. Okay, I'm going to mention the three more commons in my experience, which are a hypogenetic right lung, we just saw an example, agenesis of one lung, and congenital bronchial atresia. All three of them can be suspected in the plain film, sometimes diagnosed, and always will be diagnosed with the CT. Let's see another case. Oh, I'm sorry. I just said that, but I'm going to repeat it. In the hypogenetic right lung, one or two lobes of the right lung are congenital absence, and the imaging findings are a small hemithorax, there is mediastinal sheath, and a small hilum. And the scimitar vein is visible in the plain film in about 50% of the cases. So if you suspect this abnormality, you have a 50-50 chance of diagnosing it in the plain film. We can see another case. This one is also a hypogenetic right lung with a small right hemithorax compared to the left one. Mediastinal shift, apparent a little bit of dextrocardia, and especially the abnormal vein there, which, as I said, if you see it, clinches the diagnosis. You see that in the coronal reconstruction of the chest, okay? And again, this is, in my experience, is not rare. I will bet you that probably the your audience, the people that are listening to this presentation probably will see one case before the year ends. The second condition you have to know about is not rare, is unilateral lung agenesis. In this malformation, one of the lungs, either the right or the left, does not develop. There is a 50-50 predominance. And then the image findings are of the extreme collapse of the right or the left lung. It said that there is no lung. You have an opaque hemithorax with marked volume loss and mediastinal shift. This is an example. This is a 40-year-old man with cough. And what we see is a typical example of a marked collapse of the left lung in this particular case. There is a white hemithorax, herniation of the right lung towards the left, and crowding of the ribs because of the marked loss of volume of the right hemithorax. This appearance has a very easy differential diagnosis among three conditions. Agenesis of the lung, carcinoma with occlusion of the left main bronchus, or pneumonectomy after surgery. But if the patient is asymptomatic and we have no knowledge of previous surgery, the most likely diagnosis is agenesis of the lung, which you can prove with the CT, not necessary to inject contrast. You see the herniation of the right lung, the absence of the left bronchus. There is no left main bronchus. There is a right one, which is normal. And there is no lung here, okay? There is a thickened pleura, but there is no lung. And this is a diagnosis, a positive diagnosis of a non-significant finding, which is a genesis of the left lung. And the third condition I want to talk to you about is a congenital bronchial atresia, which is a focal lesion of the lung, which occurs in a segmental bronchus that is absent. There is a proximal interruption and the bronchus is not present. This causes overinflation of the affected segment and accumulation of mucus. And then the imaging findings result from this histopathology findings. There is an area of increased lucency con air trapping and mucus impaction. If you see that, you can suspect bronchial atresia. This is one case. This is a patient that was referred to our hospital for needle biopsy of a pulmonary nodule. Just at the first glance, we can see that this is not a nodule. The appearance is very typical. If you draw that there, it's very typical of the mucus impaction. And the same thing happens in the lateral view. There, you have the appearance typical of a mucus impaction. Therefore, this apparent nodule was not biopsied, and instead FCT was done. In the CT, the mucus impaction is confirmed with calcification, which is a common occurrence in mucus. And then in the lung view, in the inspiration view, we see a hyperlucent lesion with a mucus impaction inside. And then in the expiration view, we see air trapping. There is increased lucency of this area and the mucus impaction in the center. This is practically pathognomonic of congenital bronchial atresia. If you want more confirmation, you can do a bronchoscopy. Will eliminate any other possible cause. Another case, it is a 45-year-old man, asymptomatic. At the first glance, you see a sort of emphysema in the right upper lung. The there is a hyperlossal lung compared to the left hand. There is very limited vasculature there, but in the middle, there is this nodule. This nodule represents a mucous impaction seen in FAST. Of course, you are not going to make the diagnosis in this PAHS radiograph, but you can suspect it and confirm it with the CT, and there you have a nice reconstruction, the absent bronchus, and the mucous impaction inside, which now looks really like a mucous impaction, and then the hyperclarity of the upper segment. That is congenital bronchial atresia. Okay, remember that. So, in conclusion, to finish the congenital lesions, remember that they are not uncommon in the adult because most of them are asymptomatic. And they are easily suspected if we know the imaging presentation. CT is diagnosis. As a basic tip to diagnosing congenital lung abnormalities, I can give you that the patient is asymptomatic and that the lung may look very abnormal. This combination of apparently conflictive findings should make you think of congenital malformation and do a CT that, as I say, is diagnostic. And case number three, 54-year-old woman with pain in the chest, and the lung is obviously abnormal. There is a white hemithorax, and I'm going to give you four possible diagnoses. This is a carcinoma of the lung, this is a congenital agenesis, or this is a left pneumonectomy. And if you cannot make up your mind, you can say any of the above. Again, the reminder, always ask yourself, is the abnormality significant? I leave you alone, stop the presentation, and make up your mind. I'm sure you will make the right diagnosis because it is a very easy case. Okay, back to the presentation. Again, what we see is the hallmark of the carcinoma, congenital agenesis of the lung, and left pneumonectomy. All of them look the same, but there is a difference here because we see metallic sutures over there. When we see metallic sutures, we can be sure that the patient has been operated on. So our correct diagnosis should be left pneumonectomy. And when we look at the clinical history, the patient has been operated on for carcinoma of the lung. I'm showing this case to emphasize the importance of metallic sutures in the chest. And this is the third chapter of the presentation, changes after surgery. Nowadays, surgery is changing. We don't have a classic surgery any longer, or we don't have much classic surgery. And now we do, what surgeons do most of the time, video-assisted surgery. And they don't leave any marks, or they don't leave many marks in the chest, except that they use sutures that are metallic. So if we identify metallic sutures, then we can be sure that the patient has been operated on, and that can be very helpful if you are taking an examination and you see an abnormality that you cannot explain. For example, this patient, when you look at the left lung, there are no problems. On the right lung, there are some lines there, and it's sort of a scar in the middle, radiating to the right and into the inferior part and to the left, which cannot be very well explained, except that when we take a calm down view, there is a scar here, definitely, but there is a ring chain of staples, and there is a second one there, see? They are very easily depicted if you take a calm down view of your enlarged image. And then now we can say that this patient has been operated on with videothoracic surgery, and that explains the changes. Another patient, 23-year-old woman with cough and non-discrete left upper lobe infiltrate. We see that there is an infiltrate, triangular infiltrate. Now, if you look at this, your first impression will be a tuberculosis, probably, among other things, of course. But tuberculosis always comes to mind when the patient has an infiltrate in the left upper lobe. Let's look at the condom view. The condom view, we see in the center of the triangular infiltrate, there is a longitudinal ring chain of staple, surgical staple. So we know this patient has been operated on, and these are changes after an endoscopic left upper lobe bunionectomy for recurrent pneumothorax. And we can identify that as a non-significant finding secondary to surgery and forget about doing any other examination. And to finish, let me show you the last case, which is a very interesting case that I saw last year. And I think we can have some teaching from this case. This is a 39-year-old woman, which in March 2008 had a tumorectomy for carcinoma of the right breast. And in February 2009, about 1 year after the intervention, she discovered a lump in right axilla. And of course, MRI was done and was interpreted as an enlarged lymph node with necrotic center. This MRI at the time, there is a mass there interpreted as a lymph node. And a fine needle biopsy was done. The findings were not specific. There was no sign of malignancy. And it was decided not to do anything and keep checking the lady with yearly MRI and ultrasound. And MRI and ultrasound didn't change over the years. So everybody was very happy until in January 2019, about 10 years after intervention, the patient discovered a discrete ulceration on the right axilla. So a new MRI was done and compared to the previous one. This is MRI of 2009. There you have the mass. In 2019, there is some change, not much, but there is some change. The mass has increased slightly in size and the interior looks different. And since everybody was puzzled with the mass, it was decided to review all the previous examinations, x-ray examination, including the chest x-rays. And this is a chest x-ray, PA lateral chest x-ray, taken when the patient initially discovered the mass in February 2009. I'll give you 5 seconds to look at the right axilla and see and determine if you see anything. And obviously you see some metallic density, metallic opacity there and there. And I'll give you a countdown view. In the PA view, the metallic opacity is not very well depicted, but on the lateral view, it has an undulating aspect, very typical of a radio opaque marker in a gauze. So we record the patient and we took another study of the axilla in 2019, and then we see the typical markings of a retained surgical gauze in the right axilla. There is a mass there, very well seen against the fat content of the axilla, and in the middle, the radio-opaque marker of the surgical gauze. So, as a chest radiology, it makes me very proud to say that we made the diagnosis after 10 years of taking 2 biopsies, 9 MRI, 9 sonograms, and 1 PET-CT. And that is to, again, stress the importance of the plain film, especially when you are looking at metallic markers, metallic staples, or whatever that indicates that there is a foreign object in the chest. Remember, metallic opacities are foreign to the body, and when found, always consider previous surgery as the cause of the finding. And to finish, remember our first question in front of the abnormal finding or apparently abnormal finding in the chest is to ask ourselves, is the finding significant? And now think of the 3 more common causes of non-significant finding. First, surgical changes. Identified by mostly by the presence of radio-opaque sutures or radio-opaque structures. They are very common nowadays. Second, normal variants that involves the skeleton, the chest, and you had to know the more common. I have shown here the four that I think are more common. And finally, congenital lung malformations that in my experience are not unusual in the adult and can be diagnosed if we think they're basic, if we think of them and we know their basic manifestation. That is all. Thank you very much for your attention. This was, or this is, the last webinar of this series. And we'll start again with the second series of abnormalities, exploring abnormalities in the chest in September, October of this year. Thank you very much and God bless.